Bonnie Amon, thanking you for listening to Harambe Radio. Harambe, Harambe, Harambe.
Working together for progress.
Feel the oneness of Harambe.
Keep it right there.
Keep it right there.
Keep it right there.
Welcome to HarambeRadio.com. This is your funkstress Patrice Choc'let Banks, and you are tuned in to Everybody is a Star. Now, once again, I'm excited. You guys know I stay excited. So, once again, tonight's guest is an original member of a very hot Motown group who came along at a time when the label really needed them. Motown had lost several of their hit groups, including the Temptations, the Four Tops, and the Jackson Five, when Rick James and Switch successfully turned the trend. The spotlight tonight is on Phillip Ingram. Hey, Phillip.
Hey, girl. How you doing?
I'm doing good. Thank you so much for joining us tonight here on Everybody is a Star.
Oh, thank you for asking me. I appreciate the privilege.
No problem. So this hour flies by, so we're gonna jump right in with both feet and get started. You ready?
I'm ready.
Okay, so let's start from the beginning. Hometown. Where do you hail from?
I'm from Akron, Ohio, and it's funny. Switch is getting ready to do a show in Akron, Ohio, July 24th. Our first time since we left. So. We played, you know, the bigger cities, Cleveland, Dayton, Cincinnati, Columbus, but so it's going to be a pretty
huge.
Special thing. Yeah,
yeah,
it's
that's
going to
be huge. Okay, cool. So
yeah.
Akron, okay, so Akron is a little, because if you're calling Dayton a big city, Akron must be little.
in comparison, honey, we're 30 miles south of Cleveland, so, you know, they sent us there. Yeah, you're right.
Okay, it must, because I spent time in Dayton, so I know that Akron must be really little. So let's shout out your schools. Where'd you go to school?
Elementary school was Robinson Elementary, then to Goodyear Junior High, and then to East High School, and graduated in 1976.
Okay, so we're shouting out East High School, Akron, right?
Yep, exactly.
All right. Okay, so now, what were your first musical influences? How did you get introduced to music in your life?
Well, you know, I have a musical family. What's interesting is it's six kids. We did not get it from our parents. We actually have no idea where it came from. But my oldest brother, Henry, he started, you know, there's a piano in the house, and he never took lessons or nothing. So he grew up. My sister Joyce, then, you know, there was James. And then it was Janice, David, and all of us could sing and play. I'm the youngest, but what was interesting was James was my influence into the music industry. He was, when he was 14, we're 6 years apart, so I was 8.
And let's just say this, for those who don't know anything about music whatsoever, we're speaking about your brother James Ingram.
Exactly, James Ingram.
Okay, okay.
So when I'm a little boy, he used to take me around to rehearsals, and, you know, be seeing the drums, and I'd be seeing the keyboards and stuff, and he'd be like, you know, hey, you have your little brother, man, don't touch this. And I'd be like, dang, man, why you bring me, you know?
Okay.
But I was so excited. I was like, oh, this is what I'm going to do. I mean, so, yeah, I got, so basically James was my inspiration into the industry, and then he left.
So let me ask you something. So yeah. Even though you had a piano at home, It never crossed your mind to sit down and play or tinkle with the piano at home?
Well, you know what? I started off on drums and percussion. In fact, the first band I joined, I joined to play percussion. And we had a piano there. I would tinker with it. But when I was 13 when I joined my first band, they were like, you know you can sing? You know, we sang around the house, but we hadn't really, they hadn't pursued it. So I was like, so mainly drums and percussion. And then I got into the piano when I was about 12 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So
that's when I started playing the piano.
Okay. So in school, did you do anything musically in school? Because that's when they had instruments and band and orchestra and all that. So did you try out any of that in school? Because it sounds like you didn't know you could sing yet, right?
Well, you know, I knew I could sing. In seventh grade, you know how they have, in Ohio, we had these was the junior choirs and stuff, high school choirs,
right.
And we had these May festivals, these summer festivals where different schools would perform. So, yeah, I had been singing and that stuff, you know, since I was probably about the same time, 10, 12, something like that. So, yeah, no, I knew I could sing, but, you know, that was all group singing, never lead singing until I got into my first band, which was Raw Soul. You ready for that?
Yeah. I'm ready. Well, let me ask you this. Did your mom and dad, did they, like, play any music around the house? Did you, like, you know, any gospel, any jazz, any blues, anything like that around the house?
I mean, they'd play it, but, you know, it's like I said, since I'm the youngest, when I grew up, the family was, that's what they did. You know, they sang and stuff. Not as a family, but just kind of individually. Like, my sister Janice, she plays piano and she sings. And but Henry was kind of like the focal point, you know. When I was born, he was 12 years old.
Okay.
That means James was only 6. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
My mom did say that when James was 3 years old, he said, "Mama, I can sing." You know, so he used to sing when he was little. So yeah, we all did that. But what's funny is we never did it as a family. We never performed together. I think the years apart made a huge difference. Like Henry and I are 12 years apart. James is 6, and so by the time, think about it, when I'm 10 years old, Henry is graduating from college. You know, he's 22. And James, you know, and you don't tend to run in the same circles when, you know, you're 16 years old and you got a 10-year-old brother, that type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, but James, like I said, he did take me around the rehearsals, and that was just stirred up my interest. Matter of fact, he was with a band called Revelation Funk. Howard Hewitt is also from Akron. Howard was with a band called Life. And, you know, all of us were singing around doing, you know, the local scene. But, man, I'm going to tell you, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to call you man. When James performed with the Revelation Funk, they did this show. They just came back from doing some show in Canada. I was 13 years old, and they were just like, man, they were ridiculous, even as a local band. I said, you know what? This is what I'm doing. I knew then. This is it.
Okay, and your group was called what now?
Raw, R-A-W, Soul.
Raw Soul. So is that a name you came up with?
Oh, no, they were already existing. And Yeah, and then, I joined to be a percussionist, and the keyboard player, you know, we were messing around. He said, man, you can sing. So I literally got pushed out front. I still played percussion, but I got pushed out front at 14 years old. I still remember at 14 years old singing You're Still a Young Man by Tower Power.
And that's one of my favorites.
Honey, me too, that little 6-8 thing.
Okay.
So, you're still a young man. I mean, but imagine me at 14 singing You're Still a Young Man. They're like, yeah, you're right, you're still a young man, you know, but.
Okay.
But
a young man,
like,
that can sing on top of that.
Yeah.
And had all the little girls. I know all the little girls were just swooning, and that had to be a plus for you. That had to kind of motivate you a little bit too.
Oh, of course. I was listening today to the one you did with Augie last week, and I was laughing because he said, them girls start coming around, so he gave up a saxophone. So that was funny. Yeah, but, yeah, that's true. You come in, you know, you're becoming a teenager, and then you hormones going all over the place, and, oh, yeah. So you.
And then you realize that you can sing, and then you realize that girls like guys that can sing. It's all over then.
You know what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
It's just something
I
about
know
that
exactly
combination.
What you So Raw Soul was like your first group that you were really in. So at that point, were you guys winning all the talent shows? Were you what kind of gigs were you guys doing?
It's funny you asked that. We would do they had a place called Firestone Loco. They had some lounges, the Britton Hill Lounge, the Mix-In Lounge. And when we were our third year together, I don't remember what the competition was, but we got a trophy for the number one band in Akron. And what was interesting is our drummer at the time, he also worked at the union. So my first introduction to, like, the professional side, Rufus and Chaka Khan, remember the Hughes Corporation? Don't Rock the
Yeah,
band.
I remember Hughes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we got to actually open up the show for them. So, you know, when you're in a local band, you open up the show for some bigger artists. We're like,
right, right.
And so,
because that way you're getting exposure, and that
exactly.
So that's a good reason why they don't pay you, because you're getting exposure.
Yep. And then after that, what was interesting, we opened up for Three Dog Night, which was kind of a weird thing, because, you know, Three Dog Night,
mm-hmm.
they was more rock, but we got to open up for them, which was interesting.
Mm-hmm.
But when I thought we were really going to happen, Eddie LeVert and Walter Williams, you know, from the OJs, they lived up in Cleveland at the time. They heard us and took an interest in us. They had a record label and was going to do some work with us. And we actually cut a song. My first song when I was 16 years old was called Confusion. And I was one of the co-writers and Keep the People Grooving. That was, I actually still have a copy of that stuff. And the OJs are singing on it. So you know how it is. Like, oh, man, this is it.
So you were writing songs at 16 years old that were getting recorded.
Yeah, my first song with the band. Yeah, co-writing.
Okay.
And but by that time, I was playing the piano because, like I said, I started when I was about 12. I just started picking up stuff because that was the time when Stevie was just winning every Grammy that came out, you know, every album. Songs in the Key of, I mean, not Songs in the Key of Life, but Music in My Mind literally changed my life as a singer.
Okay.
This one girl, a friend of mine, her name is Mary, she remembers me singing Mary Wants to Be a Superwoman tour. And this other girl hit me up on Facebook, said, remember when you used to sing, remember that, every day I want to fly my kite? Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Every
yeah, I remember
day I
that.
Get on my camel.
Yes,
I used to sing
baby.
That. Yeah.
You were singing that to Mary. So you learned that at an early age. So listen, I bet you it was chaotic around your family. Was James still at home when you were at home?
You know, this
also
is what's funny. This is a funny story because James was, he left when he was 20. And so when he left, I was just getting into my band.
Mm-hmm.
So what he remembers is me playing basketball and riding my bicycle. And, you know, he was out in California. And, of course, you know, he wasn't known as a solo artist. They came out here with a Revelation Funk. They broke up. He stayed, was with a band called Different Bags and was doing some stuff around the world. But, you know, not as a solo artist. So when I was 18, so 4 years had passed, James didn't know I was this serious about music.
Mm-hmm.
And when I called him, I said, hey, man, I'm coming out to California. I still remember. He said, for what? And I said,
for what?
I know. Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, you're the only one who go out in California.
Right.
I said, because I said, and I'll tell you this story, but how that developed. But I said, we have a record deal. He's like, nigga, what you mean you got a record deal? I'm in Akron, and I have to tell you that story. But, yeah. He was actually very proud and supportive of me because here was his little brother, and, you know, because that was literally about 4 years from the time he left home. I'm sitting up here with a record deal. And
okay.
He wondered how did this all happen, but I'll get to that point.
Okay. So, all right. So what we're going to do now is we're going to listen to one of the songs that you submitted, and the first song is I Want to Be Closer. Can you tell us a little bit about I Want to Be Closer?
Yeah, the reason I picked this, because, you know, Switch, we had quite a few hits. Bobby and I were the lead singers, and this was our second hit on our first album, and it's a duet with Bobby and I. And it's interesting, when we do it today, because people thought we were a singing group, but we were a self-contained band because of the harmonies, we get a standing ovation even today when we do the song. It's just one of those Switch classics. But, yeah, that's why I said let me give you some old Switch.
It really is, and it's a beautiful song, too. So, all right, we're getting ready, because the harmony, and I know
See, that's
that,
what I'm saying. That's
yeah,
what's
the harmony.
You guys are a singing group.
I know.
Matter of fact, Patrice, let me tell you this right quick. We went down in Jet with the Temps, with, in other words, with singing groups, the Stylistics, not with Earth, Wind & Fire, the Commodores, you know what I mean? Because
right.
of the vocals. It's like,
right.
we were self-contained. We should be over here, but they didn't put us there. We're still listed as a singing group as if we didn't play instruments.
Right, right, right. And I understand that because I remember. So here we go. I Want to Be Closer.
Thank you.
right. So now we're going to go back. So you call James. You tell him that you're coming out. So Russell had done everything it could do. And how did that go? How did you guys disband?
It's funny. This is a funny story. We were doing a show at Bookto High School, and the guy that was working with us, his name was Richard Hearns. He's dead now, but he was managing the group. And he was one of them, you know, didn't take no mess. So, you know, high school, usually they get the money. We're in the middle, folks dancing in the aisles. He pulls the plug while we're singing. He says, stop, don't play another note. This woman ain't going to, he ain't say woman, he says some other stuff. This woman ain't going to give us our money. In front of everybody, I was so embarrassed. I said, this is ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was like, okay, it's time to go.
Okay.
And the way I met Greg and them, Greg Williams, who actually put Switch together, he had been with a band called the TNT Flashers, and they had come to California back in 74, and Barry White had taken an interest in them, changed the name to White Heat. They did an album on RCA. Bobby was a part of that, so was Greg and Jody, and they ended up being a part of Switch, but they were living in Akron, and when I was, you know, when Rawlso was, like, getting the trophies and stuff, we used to do shows with the White Heat. So, you know, again, we're like hanging with them. And so Greg comes to me and says, hey, man, I want to put a group together that's some cats that can sing, play, pretty much do everything. Just And so that was literally December 1976. Somebody gave us some money, took us in the studio. We recorded about 8 songs. And they came out to California and was in the Motown building to visit the lawyer that helped them with their deal back in, you know, with RCA, back in 74, and ran into Jermaine on the elevator. This is one of these weird stories, but Jermaine had come on to the 18th floor and got off on the 5th, and they were like, I should have gave him a tape. So they went back up. Jermaine was sitting in this car, and they ran to this car right before he left and said, hey, man, we just want you to check this out. He said, okay. He listened to it on the way home. He was living in Thousand Oaks at the time.
And this is
and
Jermaine Jackson. Okay.
I'm sorry about that. Yeah, Jermaine Jackson. Mm-hmm. And he said, dang, man, this is great. What's happening? They're like, we want a deal. He said, you got to be kidding. That was January, literally 3 or 4 weeks after we had gotten together. And we were signed May of 77. So that's why I was so nuts. James, when I'm calling to tell him I'm coming out, I came out in March of 77.
Right.
He had left 4 years ago, not even knowing that I was at serious about music. You know, I'm playing basketball and riding my bicycle, and then he's like,
right.
Wait. That's why he said, nigga, what you mean you got a deal? You know, it's like, so.
And how you get a deal in Ohio when I'm here in California?
Exactly. And I'm hustling. You know, I'm up here hustling. And it's like, you know, so, yeah. It was funny, but
so
he was, like, saying, very supportive.
So when you came to Los Angeles, did you stay?
No, actually, Motown put us up. They put us up. Remember, it's now at the Radisson. They put us up in the Holiday Inn on Hollywood and Highland.
Okay.
That was literally our home. And we had to do a showcase for Berry Gordy, you know, Suzanne DePass. It was a whole bunch. And matter of fact, this is how the name came about. Because when we did it, Berry was very impressed, even though they had heard the music, you know. And let's face it, you know, Jermaine was Berry's son-in-law.
Okay, let's stop for a minute. How did it feel? How did it feel knowing that you guys were getting ready to play for Berry Gordy, Suzanne DePass, and I don't know who all that you were getting ready to play for.
Tony Jones.
What did that feel like?
The fact that Motown, when they said they ran into Jermaine Jackson, you know, it's one of those. So they put him on the phone, but you know how that is. You can put anybody on the phone. So we were like,
right.
And but it's like, he convinced us that it was him, so we were just like, man, this is it. This is going to happen. And so when we came out here, Jermaine, literally, you know, the first day we was here, he came to the hotel. He met us, had his guitar player at the time, Mike McGlory, who played all the stuff on, you know, They'll Never Be, I Call Your Name, all the solos and guitar stuff. And he's actually with us now. But, Jermaine came down that first day, so we just like, oh, man. And so Jermaine was really coaching us and telling us about the showcase. So, yeah, we were excited, but it's like, okay, when they say this is it, we better bring it. We knew we had to bring it because you're right. It was icons, Suzanne DePass, you know, Tony Jones, Barry Gordy. I mean, it was just like, it was overwhelming.
I know it wasn't. So when you found yourself standing on that stage and you guys were about to hit, did you even look out in the audience and hone in on the faces, or did you just, like, could not pay attention because you didn't want to trip out?
Actually, you know what? I had to not think about it because I was so blown away. And the fact that one of the things that Jermaine said, because Jermaine had been down to rehearsals, and he was just, like, everything he was doing, like, I want to be with you. He said, I mean, yeah, man. He had just left his brothers 2 years prior.
Mm-hmm.
So the Jacksons had already moved over to CBS. Jermaine was, you know, here from 75, here to 77. We kind of took it. It was almost like he was with his brothers again, you know what I mean, hanging out with his band.
Right.
And that energy, we fed off of his energy feeding us, and he was all excited. And I think that's what really helped us. So he took away that whole stigma of, like, man, y'all get replaced. You know, it was like, man, he came back. Barry and him was already excited. They just need to see you. They just going off my word. It was that type of thing.
Oh.
And I think that's what helped us. You know what I mean?
So he was extremely enthusiastic. So evidently you guys must have killed it.
Oh, so much so that I still remember Barry Gordy's words to us. He met with us. We pulled back in the room, and he said he was very impressed. He was blown away. And then he said this, and Patrice, you can appreciate this being with bands. He says, the only thing that can mess you guys up is you.
Right.
And that's exactly what he told us. Like, in other words, I'm behind you guys, but they understand how bands, you know, have that little mess that goes on from time to time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So tell me about how the name Switch came up, how you guys came up with that name.
Well, in our showcase, that's what I was going to say, when we were doing if Bobby was out front, I would get on the keyboards. If I was out front, Bobby was on the keyboards. And if me and Bobby was out front together, Greg and Eddie was on the keyboards, but they also played horns. And so when we were in the meeting, next couple of days with Suzanne DePass, she actually said, I've never seen so much switching in my life. And I'm always being silly. And I said, why don't we call the band Switch? Kind of like a joke. And everybody laughed. And then the next day, Jody, the drummer at the time, he was like, I mean, you know, Motown focused on that. We presented it to them. They said, love it. Yes, yes, because that's really who you guys are. You guys can sing anything. You can, you know, play anything. It's like perfect. So they loved it. And they went with it. But, yeah, it was really Suzanne DePass who made that comment. I've never seen so much switching in my life off of instruments and stuff. Yeah, from my showcase.
Here you were in L.A., your career was getting ready. You felt that you guys were getting ready to catapult to the top. So coming from little bitty Akron, how did that feel? Were you able to, you know, maintain, or did you wild out? Or I'm talking about you personally.
Now, you know, it's funny. It's funny. Actually, I was able to maintain. There was a special, you know, Unsung, that comes up.
Yeah,
they did
I've seen every single one of them.
Okay, so you saw the one with DeBarge and us?
Yes.
And Switch? Okay. And I was telling somebody, I said, you notice in that whole Unsung, because they really uncovered a whole lot of stuff, and there was a Vibe magazine had done an 8-page article on Switch and DeBarge, and the name of the article was, you know, Broken Dreams had our picture, and had DeBarge's picture, and both of them, the pictures were shattered, like the case was shattered.
Mm-hmm.
And
it
starts with, I have some problems, you know, from all this love, and no one can seem to solve them. And so in that Unsung and in Vibe, you see nothing, which I'm proud of, you see nothing wild about me. And I owe that to my parents. We were just raised properly. It's like, you know what, you know, when I went home, even though Switch was like, you know, crazy, rising up the charts, I'd go home and Akron have to take out the trash. You know what I mean? My father definitely kept us humble.
Right.
It ain't because you Phillip Ingram a Switch. I mean, it's, no, you, little Negro, you need to take out the trash. I mean, it was, you know, he wasn't mean, but it was
right,
just,
absolutely. Just,
yeah,
you know, kept you grounded.
Kept
you
grounded.
So you were taking out the trash, and then when James would come home, did he have to mow the lawn?
Yeah, oh, yeah, and because, you know, in the wintertime, we had to shovel the snow and everything.
Shovel the snow, do all that.
Oh,
I heard
yeah.
that. Dad kept y'all in line. Okay.
No, he did.
And that's a wonderful thing. because here you are today. So many accomplishments. I hope that we just have enough time to just get through all the things that you've done. We're going to definitely try because it's a lot. So, but now we're going to listen to a song you submitted called The Second Star to the Right. Can you give me a little tidbit about that?
Yeah, and the reason I was thinking about this when I was listening to what you did with Augie, this is actually a song I did as a guest vocalist for Disney. Walt Disney was doing these children's records called, this was called Rockabye Baby. And this is actually from Peter Pan. And I'm telling you, when I got this arrangement, I was like, man, this is so cool. I couldn't grasp. I was like, how is this from Peter Pan? Because they sent me that too. And finally, I was like, I learned Peter Pan that the second star to the right. You know, I was like, okay. And then when I got back, the backgrounds is me, Jim Gilstrap, Kevin Dorsey, and Daryl Fennessy, and I'm singing the lead. And I'm going to tell you, Choc'let, this song, because you know, I do a lot of sessions and stuff where people didn't know me or my work, and could I have some of your work? I would send this song first and some other songs. I got more work from this song as a guest vocalist than probably, you know, even over the stuff in Switch, commercials, movie stuff, it's nuts. So that was one of the reasons why I did
that. Not only are you singing it so beautifully, you have such a beautiful, smooth, you know, real soothing voice. But I, you know, as I'm downloading and stuff, I'm listening to the lyrics, and who knew that the lyrics were saying all of this? You know what I'm saying?
Matter of fact, they said,
it's a deep song. I said, shoot,
when they said,
I like this song.
What's from Peter Pan? They said, well, you think of this like you singing this to your little baby girl. And I heard this arrangement. I said, my little baby girl, please. It's like I'm singing this to my baby. You know.
Okay. And that's what it sounds like too. But who knew? Like I said, that you know the lyrics are profound and it's something that all you funkologists need to really just download and check out the whole song. Unfortunately, I can't play the whole song, but when you get a chance, check it out. It's called The Second Star to the Right. Star to the right. Oh, it's gonna be shining bright for us, girl. Oh, twinkle, twinkle, little star. How we wonder where you beautiful song. And you were just saying on the break that you did the demos for Beauty and the Beast and what else?
And also A Whole New World.
A Whole New World.
I did that with Walter Afanasius. He was actually Robbie Buchanan, I should say, did the arrangements and called me up to sing those. The first one I did with Sally Dworsky, and the second one I did on with a girl named Susie Benson. We sang that, and, you know, those are huge records. Matter of fact, so Walter was, he was telling me, I got to work with Walter for years. I became his vocal contractor, but he wanted me to, he kept saying, why don't we just keep Phillip? He really was fighting for me.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, and at the time, James and, Linda Ronstadt. Because before,
now,
you know,
Walter,
James and Linda.
Who are Walter?
Walter Afanasty was a big record producer.
Okay. We got to know that.
And songwriter.
We got to make sure we put that knowledge out there.
Yeah, he's the one, he's responsible really for a lot of the Mariah hits, you know, Hero, they wrote that together.
Okay.
A lot of stuff with Celine Dion, he did. I did a lot of vocal contracting, you know, like putting the singers together with him back in that time. But what happened with that song, Disney had not done a song with a hit record behind it. James and Linda Ronstadt was the first one, Somewhere Out There.
Mm-hmm.
Remember that? That was the first time that had been done. And so then Disney jumped on the bandwagon, so they wanted someone with more of a bigger name, and that's why they went with Peebo. But Walter, he said, man, he's always loved the way I had sung those original demos. I actually have them both on my site just for streaming.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Okay, so, all right, where do we leave off? You were with Switch. Okay,
yep.
So now how did it feel as, when did you know, let me put it this way, when did you know that Switch had, did you ever feel, when did you get that feeling that you had finally made it with this group Switch? And let me add that I know that you brothers had a huge following, especially ladies, because you guys sang those ballads, and as a whole, you know, y'all was kind of fine. You know what I'm saying? I was looking at those pictures.
Wait a minute. Kinda?
I'll take that. They're kind of fine. So what was it like, you know, being, you know, everybody being young and cute and talented and, you know, what was that like and successful?
Well, let me just back up one thing. Greg Williams, that was his vision. He actually, when he talked to me, he said he wants to put a group of some good-looking guys that could sing and play. So it wasn't just singing and playing. As a matter of fact, Motown, they even said for a band, they had never seen that many nice-looking guys in one band. And so they also played
on that.
So
that was a plan, huh?
That was Greg Williams' vision.
Huh?
Yes.
Okay.
And so when we, I'm going to tell you, for us, and you know how it is, you know, because when you have a record, like when They'll Never Be came out, we were excited, but we were already on our second album's material. You know how that is.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, we had wrote it, well, I should say Bobby had written it back in 77, and we cut it, but it didn't come out till 78, and we had already written other stuff. So we're like, dang,
right.
We need y'all to hear this stuff. But it was actually, we did a promotional tour, and you know how songs used back then, they would go back east, and then they'd work their way west coast?
Right.
So it was barely playing out here. And we went back to this promotional tour, and Jermaine and Hazel went with us, but they didn't go with us to the actual place. And all it was a signing thing. This is how nuts it was. We pulled up at this record store, and we're sitting in a limousine. This is how ignorant I was. I mean, I was 18, 19 years old. I said, hey, what's other people for? And the chauffeur started laughing. He said, that's for y'all. I said, what do you mean that's for us? Because our record was number one in Detroit at the time. We had no knowledge. You know, you're following Cashbox and Billboard, but you don't know. I mean, you don't feel that impact till you're out there with the people. Girl, we got out the car, and I was shaking. They were pulling scarves. They were pulling on our clothes. This is what I knew. They pulled us into this. It was packed, and they had our display up. I'm like, wow, and they put us in this back room. And when we came out, they had to put us in the back room again. They said, you know what? We're going to take Switch back if you don't control yourselves. I mean, it was nuts.
Wow.
And so after that, Jermaine on purpose. He said, the reason I didn't want to go to that with you guys, I wanted you guys to feel the impact because, you know, that's what happened with them. And then, so he told us nothing until afterwards. And so we sit in the hotel half shaken, you know. Bobby and Jody got some scratches on them, you know, I mean, from these girls' nails and stuff and lost
those
some jewelry.
Those girls don't
play,
do they?
Oh, honey. And so that's what we learned. Don't wear no jewelry. Don't wear, you know, nothing that they can take, like no handkerchief, all that stuff. And we were like,
right.
But Jermaine said, you know, you never really know. Like he said, when they were, you know, Jackson 5 were coming up, they didn't know how big they were until they went to Europe and these other cities, because you don't feel it when you're here in your hometown. And that's what was happening with us. Now then, you know, K-Day was the main black station in L.A. at that time, and then that album just blew up. So that album actually did go platinum, that first album with They'll Never Be, with I Want to Be Closer, the song you played first. Yeah,
right.
That was a huge album. And then it was follow-up with, you know, I Call Your Name, which was still today has been one of our biggest hits. We actually still, we close our show with that song.
Okay. So now, how long did you guys ride this high? I mean, how long, you know, how long were you on this plateau before things started to, you know, go out of whack?
Yeah, really. Believe it or not, we did the first two albums, platinum and gold. The third album, I still have the charts. The it was us, the Barcades, Cameo, and I forget the other group. Oh, it was Ray Park, I think. We had jumped just on the momentum of, you know, the prior albums. We jumped, which, you know, is unheard of, something like 160 spots in 1 week.
Wow.
To get an article and switch the bark. It was nuts. Now, here was the problem. At this point, Bobby felt he wanted to go on his own. So Motown pulled back.
And this is Bobby DeBarge, right?
Bobby DeBarge, yes.
Okay.
Because, yeah, the group consisted of Bobby and Tommy DeBarge, Jody Sims was our drummer, Eddie Fluellen, Greg Williams, and myself, Phillip Ingram.
Okay.
Now, it's interesting because, you know, talking about how Motown was focusing on not only the group's talent but also the looks. So our first and second album had pictures on it. If you look at our third album, it's called Reaching for Tomorrow. There's no pictures on there. Motown pulled back. We lost our momentum. I mean, I really felt that was the album that would have crossed us over to really the big pop side. But there was that internal mess. And so on our fourth album, you'll see some pictures on there again. And that's when we had Love Over and Over Again, which was a top 10 R&B hit, but not as big as, you know, like I Call Your Name, but They'll Never Be or the others.
Right.
So
right.
Definitely, so momentum was lost. And then Bobby did leave, and then we had a fifth album. Call On Me was the hit from that. But, you know, not as big as those first. They thought it was only three records, but we actually did five albums.
Mm-hmm.
But three were huge.
Mm-hmm.
Three out of the five. So after that, yeah. You know, the popularity started dying. Well, I shouldn't say the popularity died down, but I definitely say the record sales went down. And then we're actually working on another album, and that's when Motown decided to let us go. And I'm going to tell you, by the time Bobby was gone,
mm-hmm.
Here's the reason I actually left the group back in 82, is because we had had a lot of turmoil with, sad to say, Bobby and Tommy. And so I was just like, you know, I was 23 years old, and they kind of wanted to get the whole group back together, everybody original, and go to another record company, and I couldn't do it. And I said,
you had enough, huh?
Yeah, and that's when I left and just started. I was actually, that's when James was, it's funny, that's when James had just done Just Once, and that came out, I think, in October 81 or something like that. And I was going through those turmoils and stuff with Switch, so in 82, I actually toured, sang background with, on that Dude tour with James and Patty Austin, mm-hmm. Phil Perry. And, you know, and then from there, I actually, that's when I call it the Q connection. That's
absolutely,
when I really
baby,
doing,
because when you got connected in that connection, you were connected, weren't you?
Oh, that's when I started doing commercials. I hadn't done any commercials up to then. And I started doing, you know, movies and a whole bunch of stuff in all the years in Switch, I had not done. And it's funny, you were mentioning that I had done a lot. It's funny, I've actually done more outside of Switch than I did with Switch. I'm just known most for Switch.
Right, and I'm going to, I'm going to, that's the very reason why I have this show, just to, you know, just to put that knowledge out there about, you know, what's going on with people, being, you know, so that, you know, I have a bunch of funkologists that listen to me, so they know that when they listen to this program, they're going to learn something they didn't know. So, yeah, we're going to definitely let them know exactly what you've been doing. Like I said, if we have time, because your bio is like an encyclopedia. So so it would take a whole show just to name all these names of all these people that you work with. But before we it has been a blessing. Before that, though, one of the prettiest songs I think you've done also is Most of All. Can you tell us a little bit about Most of All?
Yeah, buddy of mine, Todd Carlin, phenomenal keyboard player, and he's actually like the MD for Paul Anka. And him and I had worked on some stuff prior and had become good friends. And he was getting married. And you know how it is, you want to write a song for your bride. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, okay. And I didn't want here comes the bride. I said, you know what? If we're gonna write a song, why don't we write a song that can be used in the wedding, but also can be used beyond the wedding? And so he said, cool. So we got together, and Todd and I wrote this. And the reason I included this on my MySpace music page, on my Reverb Nation page, it's the number one downloaded song, the number one, gets more plays than any of the others. You know, this, I mean, a lot of them get a lot of plays, but this one gets a whole lot. And so this is, I Want to Be Close was me with Switch when I was 19. This was me, a few years ago. So, yeah,
okay.
Most of All, that's the story behind that.
Okay, Most of All.
I can still see your eyes underneath the pale skies, high above the lights of blue and red. One for every dream that lay ahead. Now the tide's finally passed, and our day has come at last. Now when I recall all the things that brought me here, I'm amazed. So let me count the ways. It's the way the wind blows through your hair, all the memories that we share. It's a thousand things that make me want to see my life. But most of all, it's you. Whenever you smile at me, there's a new world I see. But when you take my hand, it opens up a door into me that no one did before. It's your voice that soothes my soul. You're the hand that makes me whole. It's a thousand ways you brightened up my day. Most of all, it's you. There's always something waiting, some place we have to be. Sometimes I wish that time would stop and set us free. But even when we find ourselves so many miles apart, thinking of you still. My empty heart.
that was a wedding song.
Well,
a classic of all time wedding song.
To be used for his bride, but I said, no, let's use it beyond the wedding, and we came
beautiful.
Up with yeah, thank you. I appreciate
that's
that.
That's a beautiful song. So
that's one of my writing, so now you get to hear a little bit of my writing, because, you know.
Okay.
Yeah, me and
that's
Todd
not
both
fair.
Together.
You can't do everything. You have to leave. So, and I just want to say, too, the way I met you personally, you and I met.
That's right.
When I was working with Wayne Henderson a lot
of
his projects, and
yep.
we met doing background vocals on some project, I don't know what,
exactly.
but that's how you and I met through Wayne
yep.
Henderson.
But we
and
go one, way back, too.
Way like, back.
Yeah.
Like Cadillac seats.
Yeah.
And one thing about you is whenever Wayne would tell me that you were going to be on a session, I would always look forward to it because you made working fun, although, of course, singing is fun. And you live
I know what you mean.
But you were forever joking. Always having
same.
Everybody cracking up. And
wow.
Wayne would be like, okay, waiting on us to get through laughing so that we could start singing. You
yeah.
know, and I remember those days. They were a lot of fun. Okay, so now, let me see. Let me just try to name some of these credits here that you have. Like we said, you had the hookup. Once you get into that click, especially back then,
right,
in those days,
right.
that whole click, it was a click of jingle singles, singers, commercial, doing all the commercials. You guys did all the commercials. Jimmy Gilstrap was in that.
Yep.
Many of you guys. It was a whole, and it was a wonderful thing, and I was glad to see. Let me see. But you worked with people like Kanye West. With,
mm-hmm.
I'm just going to say with and for Kanye West, Celine Dion, Barbara Streisand, Bette Midler, Lionel Richie, Nancy Wilson, Gladys Knight, Santana, Johnny Mathis, some of your movie credits, Norbit, The Wedding Singer, How Stella Got Her Groove Back, My Best Friend's Wedding. You are actually
I'm the wedding singer at the end of the film, yeah.
The wedding singer at the end of the film on My Best Friend's Wedding. Captain EO had to throw that in.
When oh, yeah.
you got that Disney hookup, that was a really good hookup for you because you've done several Disney projects.
Yeah, no, I have.
Songwriting credits, Janet Jackson, The Temptations, Teddy Pendergrass, television performances, Soul Train, The Morning Show, Jackson 5, The American Dream, and One Life to Live. I had to throw that in. Commercials.
Yeah.
Burger King, Pepsi, McDonald's, In-N-Out, Coors, Stouffer's. So just an illustrious, full, blessed career. So tell me, and it's not over because it's not over till it's over. You got a whole lot left that you are doing. What is Phillip Ingram doing today?
Well, Switch got back together in 2003. We've been doing live shows around the country. Also work with Sheena Easton. Met her in 2005. A guitar player called me to she was doing a show in Malaysia, and I was able to do it. And we've now 6 years. We were talking the other day. I said, "Man, it's going by quick."
Sheena's still out there doing it, huh?
Oh yeah. Well, you know, Sheena had like 11 number one records, and a lot of people.
Yeah, she was hot there for a minute.
Oh, she was huge.
Mm-hmm.
So it's been nice, and literally, she's been all over the world. And then also do some shows, you know, as a solo artist. I've done some stuff with Wayne as well when Wayne had the, he still has it, but the Crusaders and stuff. I've done
mm-hmm.
some guest appearances with them. But I'm also doing I'm still doing writing, you know, still get to do movies and commercials. Not as like they used to be. Definitely after the strike of 2000, it slowed down quite a bit.
Right, right.
But I still do some, you know, from time to time. But I also do and I still do guest vocalists. I just did this one guest vocalist about 3 weeks ago, German violinist. I mean, I don't have a copy of this stuff yet. It is so, so pretty. And, I mean, I'm really looking forward to when that comes out. But I'm also Rex Salas. He's a keyboard player that him and I, we actually wrote Damaged Goods together and some other stuff that's on my site and phenomenal player. He's actually out with Janet Jackson right now. He's been with her for about 20 years. And he, him and I are producing this young upcoming artists. So we're also, you know, getting off into producing. And actually 2 days a week, Patrice, I teach vocals at a music college in Pasadena on Mondays and Wednesdays.
Wow.
So, yeah.
Well, that's a wonderful thing. Pasadena Music College, you said?
It's actually called the California College of Music, CCM.
Oh,
on Mondays and
great.
Wednesdays.
That is
so
great.
So that with the live performances, you know, the sessions and stuff. So, yep, still staying pretty busy.
And still traveling?
Mm-hmm. Not extensively, you know what I mean?
Okay, okay.
Yeah, like maybe 10 days at the most, but, you know, a weekend here. Like the thing we're going to do in Akron, you know what I mean? I'm going
right.
home a few days before because that's my hometown. But
right.
It's only that one show. Stuff with Sheena I got coming up back east. It's going to be like, you know, one day, then back in and, you know, go out again one day, that type of thing.
And to be back with Switch again, you know, to come full circle and be back with them again, I know that that's, and to have people still appreciate your music just as much as, you know, in the beginning, I know that's, words can hardly describe that. Now, let me ask you something. What
sure.
advice would you give young artists today?
The biggest thing is, that's a whole, that's another show. But
I
really,
know.
if I could put it just briefly, one is they shouldn't give up on their dream. They definitely have to continue believing in themselves. They have to stay true to who they are as an artist. Even with the person that we're producing, I said, don't worry about my track record. A good producer is going to bring the best out in you,
mm-hmm.
not take away from who you are. So you got to stay true to who you are. And I would say, just like I was grounded from my parents, definitely, you know, don't be getting old. Just because you got a hit record, as you know, that comes and goes. I mean,
right.
You take it as a blessing, not that you own the world. And trust me, you will have longevity in the business as opposed to, you know, little 4 or 5 year run. Cause that's what I mean by Switch. You know, 78 to 82, and then you have this, like you said, you got like an encyclopedia. So that was all after Switch. And
right.
with no mess behind it. You know, like you said, having fun in the studio, all that stuff comes out on the records. People want you back. You know, you're that type of thing. And that's
attitude,
that's probably
attitude.
The biggest advice. When I'm telling the kids at the college, and please, you know, tell them there's a dime a dozen, seriously. But relationships are forever. And
mm-hmm.
it's those relationships. Look, like the fact you and I, we haven't talked to each other in a while, but here we are, back in touch
okay.
again. Relationships.
Absolutely. Right. Absolutely.
Yeah.
And you said a key word, longevity. I mean, you know, it's a wonderful thing to be able to, in these days and times, make, you know, I like to see our brothers and sisters making the real money, you know what I'm saying, the real cash dough.
Right.
But there's
right.
something to be said also for, like, this, the music that you're making, the product that you're putting out, will people still be listening to that product? Is it classic? Will they still be listening to your music 20 years from now and,
right.
and get the same
right.
feeling 20 years from now that they got when they first heard it? You know what I'm saying? So to me, as far as I'm concerned, everything is to be said for the authenticity and the integrity of what you're doing. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Because
that
makes you a part of music history. You will go down in music history, you know what I'm saying? Because people will be listening to you forever if that's what you're concentrating on, the integrity of the music as opposed to the dollar. Now,
exactly.
Patrice,
I have to tell you this right quick.
Okay.
I now have if people have an iPhone or an iPad, they can actually go to the App Store and download a Phillip Ingram app, which has videos and it streams music. They can purchase stuff, most of all.
That was my next question. Give me all your info. How can anybody find anything out about what Phillip is doing?
Well, the iPhone app, if they have that, or iPad, is just go to the App Store and literally download the Phillip Ingram app. And then the reverbnation.com/Phillip Ingram.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, the app pulls the information from Reverb Nation, but that's, and I will be setting up a website, but right now I'm using that as my main website right now because it has so much content to it that, and there's so much that you can do with it.
Right.
But, yeah, so either the app or ReverbNation.com.
Or Facebook. Let us not leave out Facebook.
Oh, yeah. Well, see, the cool thing about Facebook, yeah. Well, Facebook, Twitter, all of those. But the cool thing about Facebook, like, you know, when I put those daily motivations up there,
mm-hmm.
and there's a picture, some people notice and some don't. If you click on that picture, it actually starts playing music, and it shows where my shows are and everything. But that's an app that's on Facebook that feeds from Reverb Nation. You follow me?
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
It's
so
cool.
Dog, now I have to check out Reverb Nation. I thought I was doing
honey,
the most. Every time I think I'm doing the most, something else comes up.
If you need some help, I'll help you out.
Well,
seriously,
thank you.
And honestly, congratulations on your success, too, with your two books, with your, you know, the...
Well, three books. I have a third book.
Me
out. Yeah, so you go to PatriceChoc'letBanks.com. But before I give that information out, you got any shout-outs?
Actually, just hometown Akron, Ohio. I know we're really looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to seeing my sister and my nieces because last time I was there was 2003, and I was there to my parents died in 2001 and 2002, so I actually went home to help my sister, my older sister, get the house ready to sell.
Okay.
So to go back with Switch, I mean, you know, Facebook, phone has just been blowing up. I'm coming, to, you know, so we're looking forward
right,
to having
right.
a great time. So, yeah, this shout-out would definitely be for Akron since we get ready to hit them hard on July
24th. And I heard that. Hit them hard. Slay them, okay? Kill them, okay?
You know what I'm saying?
And I wanted to do my weekly shout-outs. I want to shout-out to my family, to Destiny, my daughter, who is my producer, to Team Choc'let, which consists of Captain Zelda, Billy, Ray, CJ. And also, for all things Choc'let, go to my website, PatriceChoc'letBanks.com. Just released a new book, just released a new single called Straight Funk. And
it's spelled F-O-N-K.
Yes. I changed it. I'm on a mission, Phillip. I'm on a mission to reposition a whole lot of things about funk, you know. And the first thing I want to do is start out by changing the spelling of it simply because in these days and times, like when you go to these funk festivals, F-U-N-K,
mm-hmm. yep.
when you go to them, it's everything there but funk. You know what I'm saying?
Right,
so
I'm
going to let them keep the U. You know what I'm saying?
That's funny.
I'll let them have the U, and we got a revolution, a funkalution about to get started. I'm trying to get it started, okay?
Now,
I'm going to say my goodnights, but before I do, I just want to say that we're going to go out on a last song of your that you submitted called Wonderful. Can you give me a little bit, because we're just running a little bit over time, but
yeah,
can you say something about Wonderful?
That's a guest vocalist on me and Nikki Harris did this on this guy named Jim Levine, the saxophone player, and I do this on I close my show with this, and Choc'let, people are up, not Switch, my Phillip Ingram show.
Okay.
With this, people are up in the aisles dancing, and you know, I just walk out leaving them dancing, leave them, you know, where it's hanging, because it's just one of
those
cool grooves.
That's the way you're supposed to leave.
Come on, girl.
I'm
you know where we come from.
Just
you
like
know where
that.
We come from.
Leave them like that, Phillip. And
yeah.
I want to tell you, it has been so much fun, and thank you so much for joining us tonight on Everybody is a Star. And I just want to say, you are more than welcome. And anytime, okay? Keep us posted about what you're doing. And until next week, may the funk be with all y'all, okay? We get ready to go out on Wonderful.
Exactly.
Feels like I've seen